Ham Radio Now, episode 156, Propagation, for field day, if you hurry. Tomas Hood, I guess we better hurry. What's it going to be like for field day?
I think it's going to be smooth sailing in terms of space weather, adverse space weather. And I'd like to qualify what space weather typically means. Space weather.
Oh, no. You don't understand. No? We can't get into the details yet. We need to tell people how field day is going to be. Are the bands all going to be open? Can they work? Should they bother setting up a 10-meter station?
I don't think 10 meters is going to be a workhorse band. I do believe you will have sporadic E. There will be openings. With the current activity level of the sun, you're not going to have enough energy to ionize that F region for 10 meters. I highly doubt you're going to have consistent long periods of opening on 10 meters.
Okay, so sporadic 15
is going to be marginal. And 6 meter, of course, sporadic E.
Yeah.
So those that are daring and dedicated and really want to, you know, hunt for that little ounce of extra point value, stay up there and hunt that sporadic E, because it does happen.
Okay.
And if there's no stations on, you'll never know.
So we'll tell everybody what sporadic E is in just a little bit, but let's qualify you. Let's talk about who you are. I found you on Wikipedia. You're a writer, a musician, a father, and a husband. None of that says propagation. What's the deal on propagation?
Propagation is my passion. When I was about 10, I discovered my parents' Sony 4-band portable radio, and it had the shortwave band as one of those four. I tuned around, discovered this station that was just mesmerizing. It had the call sign WWV, Fort Collins, Colorado, and it gave the time signals. And I listened to
all
it long
time,
enough.
All the time.
All the time, 24/7. And I discovered that the signal would come and go, and I listened for a while to see what would happen. And at a certain point in the transmission, they started talking about the sun and geomagnetic activity and whether or not there was a storm or not. And then it was over. 1 minute worth of news about this fascinating topic of the sun. And I was hooked. Somehow I got hooked on that. And the fading in and out of shortwave signals, I started hunting the DX.
Do you remember which one of their transmitters, what frequency you were listening to back then?
I believe it was the stateside, not the Hawaiian station. And I was in Montana, so I do believe that it was the local regional coming out of, I believe, Fort Collins, Colorado.
Yeah, I was wondering if you knew what frequency. Because
that's probably 10 megahertz.
Yeah, for that.
That was right in the middle of the band on that radio. I don't think that it went down to 5. I don't think 5 megahertz was in the bandwidth of that radio.
Okay, so you listened to them, you heard the propagation stuff, and suddenly you got interested in why that signal was coming and going and what they were telling you about that. But did you understand any of it?
Nope. Had not a clue. But I did begin experimenting with the antenna, getting longer antennas, trying different orientations, noticing the fading coming in and out, and I didn't quite understand that. I also began to dabble in books about electronics, trying to understand how the radio itself worked, and learned about tubes and basic circuitry. Some people in the school noticed my interest and got me in touch with a ham radio operator. And that person began to kind of mentor me a little bit in electronics, explained a little bit about the sun. But my hunger was not satisfied in any form of the word. I went to the library and asked them if they had any scientific books about the sun. Of course, I was young, so they brought out all of the science books that are geared to a young reader, which were okay, but they just didn't feed my intense desire to really understand what was going on. So probably for the next decade, I kept searching for something that would unlock, and finally discovered that interlibrary loan program that many libraries have. And one of the librarians helped me research some books. Big, huge books came in the mail, full of this math that was like Greek to me. Had no clue what the math meant. But there was stuff in between the mathematical formulas, pictures and graphs talking about sunspots, sunspot cycles, the ionosphere and how it gets energized. And I finally began to unlock the mystery. And I still have that deep love. It's like my first love. That and radio, you know, you never leave your first love.
Yeah. So we'll see where that led you to in just a moment. But there was a question I was going to ask that I forgot when we were talking about Field Day. The propagation forecast that you gave us, is it any better than what we get from the weatherman about what the weather's going to be 3 days out? We're recording this Wednesday night.
Sure.
So what you're looking for this weekend, what's your confidence rating?
Well, let's look at terrestrial weather and weather forecasting here on the Earth.
That could take up the rest of the show.
Yeah, we could. But in general, you have a multitude, a myriad of data points that gather information all the time. There are so many weather stations gathering that information, and you have weather balloons and satellites. The wealth of information helps the scientists and the mathematicians better model what's going on, and their approximations are getting more and more accurate because of the immense amount of data that they can chomp on. We don't have that many data points when we talk about the sun. There's just a few satellites that observe the sun. We have some telescopes that watch the sun. We do have some amazing satellites, but they're not very many. We have the stereo satellites that have been placed into orbit around the sun so that we have a complete 360 view of the sun. But the resolution on those satellites is not anywhere near what the SDO satellites give us, the Solar Dynamics Observatory satellite.
Are they in Earth orbit?
And they are in Earth orbit in a kind of a geosynchronous to the sun, so it always views the sun at the same location and streams extreme high definition back to Earth on a pretty consistent flow, a stream, instead of just a snapshot and then you wait a couple of hours for it to download. It's almost live streaming from those satellite, that satellite.
But they would be looking at just the face that points toward us.
The face that points to us. And there's an important reason for that, because of the duty that it plays in helping scientists prepare for that eventual sure solar storm that could really impact our infrastructure. It will happen. We just don't know when.
Okay, so you're doing a good job at dodging the question, which was, what's your confidence rating for the weekend?
Fair.
So 10 meters could open up.
There are potential sunspots rotating into view. As I explained, there are some satellites that allow us to see the 360 view of the sun. And we can kind of see what's coming around the corner into view facing the Earth. There looks to be maybe two, possibly three large active solar spot regions. They may just peek around at about the time Field Day starts. If that's the case, and if they're very active, that could elevate the energy in the ionosphere and wake up those upper bands, give some support to that propagation. It just depends on how active those sunspots are and how far they rotate into view. But right now, there are very small and very few sunspots facing us. So in a sense, the sun's quiet and unlikely to do any kind of burping of plasma on the solar wind toward the Earth. So I think it's going to be calm sailing, meaning we don't expect blackouts or depressions of the maximum usable frequencies over different paths. So it's stable. Consistency is the key word here. So 20 meters, 15 meters, definitely 40 meters. Those are the workhorses, and they'll be consistent players following the sun throughout the day. So, okay. You know, you're going to have good conditions, just not on the higher bands.
Yeah, so I guess in the vernacular of the kids these days, it's going to be meh, not awesome, not terrible.
Because you don't have all of the bands playing at the same time, you're not going to get the kind of scores that you would if the solar cycle were impressively active. But you're going to have a consistent playing on those workhorse bands. People will tire their voices out, lose their voices over this weekend.
Use the voice keyer.
It's definitely going to be a good field day.
Okay. Well, that's a good optimistic outlook. Let's talk about who the heck you are now. We saw where you came from. This is where you live now. And let me see if I can get to the index page. Tomas Hood NW7US. It's the propagation column in CQ Magazine. So, turns out you have some street cred. You're a actual published propagation forecaster.
Yep, been doing it just over a decade with that magazine.
And you do a couple other magazines. At least you did anyway when CQ was publishing them. But now that it's all been jammed into the one CQ, you did stuff for CQ VHF.
Right.
And
every annual.
Yep. And Popular Communications.
Right. Monthly for that as well.
Okay. So now all that's been jammed into CQ itself.
Sure.
And there's one more that I've actually intended to do more with. The Spectrum Monitor is the successor to Monitoring Times. Right. We did an interview with the publisher of Monitoring Times. A couple of issues before they folded, he decided to close the magazine end of last year, and he said his staff may continue, and as it turns out, they did continue, and this is what they continue with. I'll tell you, give them a solid. Tell me a little bit about Spectrum Monitor.
Spectrum Monitor is a wide smorgasbord of radio. Every aspect of the radio hobby is covered in one column or another. Beautiful magazine. Ken is doing a fine job putting that together. Some of the heavy hitters from the other magazine have come aboard and continued the legacy of their columns. Great magazine. It is digital. You know, there's a lot of people that have cried foul because things have moved to the digital. But this is the digital age, and we're seeing more and more tablets and iPhones and Androids and things where everything's portable and information is at your fingertips. So publishers have to stay with the times. The Monitoring Times, I'm not exactly sure what all involved in his decision, but the writers are passionate. They, like me, the topics that we cover are in our blood. It's how we roll. We can't separate ourselves from our topic. It's almost like we are that topic, right? And so this magazine, the Spectrum Monitor, gives us a venue to spread the love of our particular topic.
The digital version that you're talking about, it's a straight PDF, which is my favorite version of digital. A CQ is on this Zinio thing, and there we go. It's okay, but
and QST is on this next something or other,
yeah,
which is another digital platform,
yeah,
and that's okay too. There, each of them seem to have some limitations, but we are still kind of early in the digital publishing scenario.
Yeah,
you know, well, the technology.
They all work. They're just the manipulation of the image is not as as smooth as PDF is. Zooming, changing pages, all that stuff, it's not quite as good, even if you've got it downloaded onto your device. And I understand that at least part of the reason for CQ is they're doing digital rights or they're doing copy protection. And PDF is difficult to copy protect. It can be done, but it's kind of clumsy and probably not all that good. So I can see why they might want to do it. Although there's also this this concept that copy protection is makes it harder for the people who want to do things legitimately, and not difficult at all for the folks that want to screw around.
Sure, the music industry went through the same convulsions, and I believe it's just beginning to smooth out, and music is more accessible to the masses. It's really interesting to see what's happening in the publishing world.
Yep. I just noticed I've got something on the screen that the audience may be interested in seeing. It's this little box down here. That's our bandwidth. The green line is what I'm sending you. The red line is what's coming back. And whenever your picture is up full, they're going to be able to see what we're doing. And at the moment, it's sitting between 2 and 2.25 megabits per second, and that's pretty good. Your picture is, just about high def and looking really good. And this being Skype, at any moment, it could all fall apart.
Right.
All right. So you do the columns. You also have a website, and this is your website. Space Weather. What's the official name of the website?
Sunspotwatch.com.
Okay.
Originally, it was a page off of hfradio.org, which is my other domain. Started in 1998 when I decided the internet was the place to be to spread the news about the sun and how radio is propagated and how it's affected by the sun. And I began to gather information from various sources that no one had yet gathered together in one place. So I was a trailblazer. I was the first, literally, the first space weather and radio propagation page on the internet.
Yeah, 1998, that was pretty pretty early.
And I've been running continuously since.
Now, the hard part here, the hard question. There was a section of your Google Plus page that spoke directly to me, and probably a lot of other hams. Next January, I'll have been a ham for 50 years. Got my first license, my novice, in January of 1965. So 50
wow.
years.
That's the year I was born.
Cool. You're making me feel old.
I feel old.
So, in all of that time, I'm one of those hams, and one that you addressed in your Google Plus page, who just turns the radio on, you know, goes back there, turns it on, and tunes around. Listens to one band, listens to another. If there's nothing going on 10, I'll go up to 15. If there's nothing on 15, I'll go to 17 and 20, and eventually I'll
never find some send activity. Out a CQ, so you'll never know if somebody else is sitting there doing the same thing.
Well, you got a point. You're probably right. I probably don't CQ on what appears to be a dead band. Okay, here, hang on a second. Around 28.4, the so-called 10-meter calling frequency. CQ, 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 calling CQ, 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 Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec, Kilowatt November 4, Alpha Quebec on 28.4. Is there anybody out there? Is this band open or dead? Nothing.
Yep.
I'm going to leave it making a little fuzz in the background. Maybe somebody else will pop up. In theory,
I will tell you. There was a time once when I woke up, the sun was just coming up over the horizon. I was in eastern Montana at the time, and I had a random long wire antenna, and I was up on 15 meters. And at the time, I was a Tech Plus, so I could only do CW. I tuned from the top to the bottom of that band and heard no one, not a peep. And I went down into the CW portion, warmed up the tubes of the radio, and I sent my CQ, and instantly a Japanese station returned, and we had a QSO. Again, there are times when that band could be very well open, and just nobody's there trying.
Yeah, usually what I'll do is, if I'm curious about 10 meters, is I'll listen to channel 19. And if it is full of heterodynes at S7 or so, I'll know 10 meters is open.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tune across 10 meters and won't be anybody there. But yeah, call on CQ. And again, 28.4 is, I guess, the place to go, or 29.6 sure. on FM. Mm-hmm. So what have I been missing? What could I have been doing all this time, and what would I have gotten out of it besides just kind of randomly hit and miss?
Well, I don't want to knock that random hit and miss. It's really relaxing and satisfying to grab your fishing rod, some bait, go down to your favorite relaxing fishing hole, sit there on the rock, twiddle your toes in the water, and cast a line, hoping that there's a bite. And, you know, once in a while you might get a reward. There's the bite. Boom, you got it. But it's just to get on there and relax and play. You know, play fishing. Let the stress go. Radio can be that. It's very relaxing. And there's that reward when something rare pops up and you catch it. The joy of the hunt. The unknown. Don't knock it. It's good. But let's say that you have that weekend where your wife wants you to go out, mow the lawn, clean out the garage, rearrange the living room, maybe paint the bedroom. Man, that's a lot of stuff to do on a weekend, but you got a couple of hours that you might be able to carve out. You want to know when to carve those hours out and what to do with that radio, what band to be on, maybe what antenna to use, where to point it, so that you can maximize that little window of opportunity that you have, and you're not just sitting there not accomplishing anything, because you want to get something just to balance out that rough weekend.
Yeah, and maybe
have
there's
something
a,
for yourself.
Maybe there's a de-expedition going.
Right.
You know what part of or the world it's you, in, and you want to pick the band that you're most likely to be able to work them on.
Or maybe you're the QRP guy who wants to go out to the local park, set up a wire antenna into the trees, and you want to know which QRP rig. Is it going to be the 40-meter, the 20-meter, the 30-meter? Which band's going to be optimal during your time in the park? Well, that's when studying and understanding propagation and space weather, that's when it plays and becomes an important component.
So you have spent several decades figuring all this stuff out. We've got approximately 40 more minutes. how do we get, we're not going to get from here to there, are we?
Well, first thing, no one, no matter how intelligent they are and how capable their brain is, can do the mathematical calculations to either ray trace or figure out the model that VioCap uses and do your own predictions. You just can't do it in your head. It's not possible. You can take pen and paper, but it'll take you hours and hours and hours to figure out all the math, because it goes point by point by point along the path to figure out, you know, the refraction and things that are going on in the ionosphere. Programs have been developed to do all of that heavy lifting. So we've got tools. And you can sit down with these tools, plug in the information, like the sunspot count, the smooth sunspot count, the geomagnetic activity, like the A and the K index. Put those things into these programs as input. Describe your antenna, describe the power, you know, describe your location. All of that data is put into the program. Then the program figures out, using all of that math and all of the data, it figures out the approximation of where your signal can reach and what times different bands can be open. All of that's modeled for you. So it's just kind of like if you're going fishing, you got that little fishing radar and you can see where the school of fish are, because it gives you the insight to what's going on below the surface of things. These tools do the same.
Is this the program that we're talking about?
VioCap is one of the standard, the gold standard of propagation modeling. it is not based on just theoretical mathematical modeling of the ionosphere and space weather. It's based on research over decades and decades and decades of the Voice of America and other stations gathering real-world data on what the propagation, the end result of their transmissions through the ionosphere under different varying conditions of sunspot counts, geomagnetic activity, etc. All of that's tabulated statistically, and it's modeled, and it's highly accurate. Programs that are based on that engine do a very good job of giving you real approximations of what your signal is going to do.
Is that a program that that I run on my computer, or is it something that runs in a browser up from a server on the web someplace?
Somebody has done a browser-based where it's residing on a server, but there are many programs that also include it as an engine that runs on your local machine. My personal favorite is Ace HF Pro. Mr. Buckner is the engineer, a degreed engineer that worked with military and government agencies as well as the Voice of America to create the wraparound that I feel utilizes best the engine. The engine is open. The API is open to the public, so people can develop programs to interface with it, or you can use it directly, but you really got to know what you're doing. The wraparound program.
Have I got the right one up there?
Yeah, Ace HF Pro.
Okay.
If you mention that I sent you there, Mr. Buckner gives a bit of the residual income that comes off of that and kicks it back to help me keep the servers that I run on the air, which is pretty costly every month. A lot of bandwidth and what I have to pay for. So anybody that buys it and mentions me, he gives me a little bit of money to help run the server.
Okay, and that reminded me that before we go too much farther and forget about it, you have your own class or tutorial.
Well, it's not actually mine. A fellow by the name of Kerry from the Space STD, Space Terrestrial Dispatch, up in Canada. He put the course together a good while ago, but it's a very solid course. It's a self-study course that's been used by the military, by different government agencies that communicate on HF. Foreign governments have used it, and many, many amateurs have used it as well. And the course covers everything. It gives you a really great understanding of the sun, space weather, things that happen on the sun, the interaction between the sun and the earth, the ionosphere, the geomagnetic field, how a radio wave travels from your antenna to the other antenna, how frequencies work, because there's a lot of magic that goes on. The course covers all of that. By the end of the course, you can do your own forecasting. You can work with Prop Lab, which is a ray tracing software that, unlike VioCap, is based on theoretical models and fascinating what you can discover using that program. The course teaches you how to use that program as well as how to understand space weather and propagation. It's very intense. It takes a long time to get through. It is self-study. Kerry used to offer a certificate when you completed and answered all the questions correctly, but he doesn't offer the certificate anymore. But you get the sense of pride in knowing you know your stuff now.
Yeah, the certificate doesn't get you on the air for the weekend finding where
exactly.
You're going to go.
Exactly.
The knowledge right. Tells you where you're going to go. Okay, so you've got a special deal going on right now.
Right. He's worked out an arrangement with me. Again, sales, the proceeds go directly to keeping my servers on. And let me tell you, there's not a huge crowd rushing in to learn about space weather. So we just barely make it and keep these servers on the air.
All right. Where I want to go next is just to learn a little bit about plain old propagation in the ionosphere. We're going to dial back to the brand new ham. I'm not sure, we may have lost the brand new ham already, but let's see if we can rope them back in. And maybe a couple of minutes worth of a basic tutorial on how signals get from here to there. About the only radios that don't require an understanding of propagation would be two FRS radios, maybe a half a mile apart.
Yeah, they communicate, in a sense, line of sight. A radio wave emanates from the antenna of the transmitting handheld and spreads out. Like if you drop a rock in a pool, you see the ripples spread out from that rock. Well, radio waves, in a sense, spread out from that antenna. And the other antenna detects or gathers some of that energy and recreates your voice, and you're heard on the other radio. Line of sight. If you walk too far away because the earth curves or there's other obstructions, or just the loss because the energy from that handheld is not as great as, say, from an FM transmitter that you listen to on your car stereo, at a certain point, you lose that line of sight energy and you no longer receive the transmitted signal. So there's limitations when you're talking about line of sight. Certain radio frequencies between a low cutoff point and a high cutoff point, in between, there are a set of frequencies that can be, in a sense, bounced off of the sky and reach farther because they're reflected. Think about a flashlight in a mirror or a wall. You walk into a dark room, you shine the flashlight against the wall at an angle, and you kind of see this ray bouncing off to a far distant part of the room. So you can kind of shape where that beam of light's going by reflecting it off that reflective surface. Radio waves in that range of frequencies act in a similar way. They can be bounced off of what we call the ionosphere, and that signal can reach far beyond your local horizon because of that refraction going on in the ionosphere.
Turns out that is a very small slice of the electromagnetic spectrum.
It is.
Of the potential radio spectrum. Not very much will bounce off the ionosphere. If we look at that sense of history, back in the very early days, not very much of the spectrum could be used because they didn't have the technology to use it.
So yeah, they had no clue that it was usable.
Yeah. And then we got that 200 meters and down thing in 1912, and we're forced.
Brute force. That was a brute force effort. More energy you can get and the bigger antennas, and you just pump that ground wave as far as you can get it.
Yeah. So once we were forced up into higher frequencies, and those higher frequencies were like 80 meters to 40 meters or so, we discovered this ionosphere thing. Did they know it was the ionosphere?
They did not. There was a lot of theories floating around. They called it the ether. I still play with that, a slogan just for fun, that I play with the ether. But it was discovered early in the 1900s that there is no such thing as the ether, but there are actually these reflective bands. And they discovered that because they were able to bounce a radio wave straight up and then receive it coming back down. And they were able to time it and figure out mathematically that the reflective layer was so many kilometers above them. And over time, in observations, they began to see that it varies in height. And sometimes the layer's there, sometimes the layer's not there. And they were trying to figure out, why did that happen? Eventually, they discovered the correlation with how much solar activity is occurring. When solar activity was high, lots of sunspots, lots of flaring activity, they discovered that these regions were very strongly ionized. That's what they discovered, that they were ionized, and that they were much more reflective of higher frequencies. And eventually, the 10.7 centimeter frequency was chosen as an approximation to gauge the amount of energy that the sun was pumping into the ionosphere to give it the strength or the lack of ionization and the 10.7 centimeter solar flux became the standard index that is used to gauge solar energy relative to radio propagation.
My frequency math isn't very good. What frequency is 10.7 centimeters? Yours isn't too good either.
it's in the gigahertz.
They just point an antenna at the sun, a dish or something, and scoop it up and measure the signal?
Basically. They've got several different receivers that continuously monitor, and then it's reported several times a day, and there's an official station announcement that's made by the official keepers of the records. And each day at the same time, the daily observed number is published.
And it varies
throughout the day. That's what people don't realize, that it actually does vary throughout the day. But there's one number that's picked every day at the same time to give us the average of what's going on.
And what changes that number? What's happening on the sun that makes it go up and down?
Ultimately, it's the amount of extreme ultraviolet energy that's being radiated by the sun. The sun is a variable radiator. Sunspots give out more extreme ultraviolet energy than if there were no sunspots occurring. Those regions produce more of that energy than when you have a non-turbulent surface on the sun. Sunspots, in a sense, are turbulation bubbling up, these currents from underneath the surface of the sun, boiling, in a sense, up and causing complex magnetic structures to break apart and explode energy toward the Earth if it's Earth-facing. So that extreme ultraviolet energy varies. The more sunspots, the more flares, the higher that energy level, and the better the ionosphere is able to propagate radio waves in that spectrum that we call shortwave or high frequencies, approximately 3 megahertz up to about 30 megahertz. It can fall below that and it can go above that, but generally speaking, we're talking about the range of 3 megahertz to 30 megahertz, the HF or high frequency range.
Is the energy that's coming out of the sunspots very directive, or is it just kind of a big plume, and as long as we can see it, we're getting it?
The latter. It's kind of like a light bulb. It emanates to all directions, except during a solar flare. A solar flare could exert lobes of energy in certain directions, and sometimes that'll increase. But overall, we're talking about a general spread of energy. There's a lot of things about the sun, a lot of aspects of sun activity that's misunderstood by the average ham. So let me clarify a couple of things. Space weather involves solar flares as well as what we call a coronal mass ejection. Those are the two primary things people relate with when they hear about the sun. If you have an ABC newscast about some big solar flare that's heading toward the Earth, and it's going to be here in a couple of days, we may see aurora, they're not exactly telling you the truth. The extreme ultraviolet and other energy that's in the electromagnetic and visual spectrum is light and travels at the speed of light. And the distance of the sun to the Earth is about an 8-minute ride for that energy. Light travels at the speed that we know is extremely fast, but it takes 8 minutes for light to reach the Earth from the sun. So when a flare occurs, when an explosion occurs, it takes 8 minutes for that light and electromagnetic energy to reach the Earth.
And that starts to charge up the ionosphere.
And that charges up the ionosphere immediately. And that's the interesting thing. It doesn't depress the ionosphere. It energizes the ionosphere. But it reaches down into the lowest level, which we call the D region. The D region, because of its molecular structure, absorbs radio waves instead of bounces them off. So most of the HF frequencies will effectively be absorbed, and we have what's called a sudden ionospheric disturbance. It used to be called a radio blackout. Most people still call it that. But scientifically now, it's called a sudden ionospheric disturbance. And that's the key. It's sudden. The moment that energy reaches the ionosphere, it's like a light switch is turned. And we have that blackout. Blackouts so only
that happens,
last.
That can happen within minutes.
It happens with that 8-minute ride. The moment that flare occurs, 8 minutes later, it hits, and it's almost immediate, that change in the ionosphere. And note, it's only on the sunlit side of the Earth. The other side of the Earth's not.
It's still doing fine.
It's fine. It's not being radiated.
Yep. Now, the D layer has an effect every day on lower frequencies. That's why 80 meters is dead during the day, and 60 meters is just fairly regional, you know, close in a region. That's because the D layer is up there absorbing those signals.
Because it's somewhat energized, some rays are reaching down that low.
Yeah. The higher frequencies pass on through. Mm-hmm. The lower frequencies, if they were able to pass on through, they'd probably bounce off the AF layer, the higher layer, just like
all the other frequencies. Well, at least the E region. And there is some 40-meter propagation that's off the E region during certain parts of the day when the D region is not as energized, and that 40-meter signal will pass through and go quite a distance.
Yeah. Okay. So there's a lot of detail.
There's a lot of detail. Yep. A lot of math involved.
All right, so the ultraviolet comes at the speed of light.
The extreme ultraviolet, yes.
Something else comes slower, I guess.
That's right. Typically, but not always, we have what's called a coronal mass ejection. The corona is one of the atmospheric layers of the sun. When a big magnetic bubble bursts, plasma is ejected out into space. Plasma, of course, is what, at that level of the sun, that part of the atmosphere, that's what we're dealing with, is plasma. That plasma is ejected out onto what's called the solar wind. There's this wind that's always emanating from the sun, and a flow of particles is always spraying out away from the sun. And it's kind of like a sprinkler. If you go in your yard, you turn on that sprinkler that rotates, you see the spiral. That's the solar wind. There's this spiral of particles streaming out. Well, the Earth rides through this stream at all times. When this plasma is ejected from a solar flare, this coronal mass ejection, or we just call it a CME, it's ejected out very fast, but not at the speed of light. It's much slower than the speed of light. It can take anywhere from about a day and a half to 4 days, depending on how fast it was ejected. Obviously, it has to be ejected toward the Earth in order for it to affect us. If it's facing out to the side of the sun from our perspective, it's not going to have any effect on us. This is going to pass by another planet, and we have no direct correlated change in anything here on Earth.
How wide a stream might that be, and how variable can it be?
The coronal mass ejection can be, if you look at the sun, you can see half of a circle spreading out. I've seen coronal mass ejections that are as big as like a half or more than a half of the solar diameter radiating out and growing in size. So massive. We're talking incredibly massive.
So they can miss us.
Miss us, actually.
It has to be a fairly oblique shot out of the sun. If it's pointing this way, well, I guess it's also that time. If it's pointing this way when it shoots this thing out, we're gonna have moved on in 4 days.
Exactly. So it has to be ahead of us a bit. There is a section of the sun surface, when we look at it, that we call geo-effective. Anything that is ejected from the geo-effective region of the sun will likely impact the Earth.
All right. So, and when that hits, what happens?
The magnetosphere, the protective force field around the Earth, does its best to deflect that plasma. And the plasma typically rides the outside bands of the magnetosphere and just passes right by the Earth over that force field, and nothing comes in. But if, and see, there's a lot of ifs here. If the solar wind and that plasma cloud are magnetically oriented so that the magnetosphere's north connects with the solar wind's south, just like two magnets, when you put north to south, they connect. All of a sudden, that magnetosphere opens up, and that solar energy, the plasma that's riding that solar wind, will actually enter in to the Earth's region and begin to ride the magnetic fields toward the poles. That's what triggers aurora.
And what happens to our precious ionosphere in either situation?
It effectively lowers the energy level of the ionosphere. So if you have...
bye-bye radio for a while, again.
Well, possibly. It could enhance certain frequencies. Let's say that you're able to communicate on 15 meters between here and Timbuktu. That path, that time of day, perfect propagation. We're right at the maximum usable frequency on 15 meters between those two stations. If this plasma rains in on the ionosphere and depresses this maximum usable frequency because it lowers the energy level, all of a sudden, 15 meters is no longer open. But it might slightly enhance the 20-meter band, and we get an opening with possible flutter from the aurora, but the path becomes a little bit stronger, or it has some echo on it, and we get a propagation opening that's lower. So there's still an opening. It just changes at what frequency that opening will be.
Do the propagation programs that we're talking about take this sort of activity into account, or is that too transient?
Nope. The VioCap model has averaged out solar activity over the full range of a solar cycle, from no activity to the very peak of the most strong activity. And all of those statistics are part of the model. And when you input the information that correlates to that, the K-index being one of those, the K-index is a measurement of how active the geomagnetic field around the Earth has become. If there's no plasma raining in and no interaction with the solar wind, our geomagnetic field is stable. It doesn't flux. The magnetic field lines are straight as an arrow. But if there is interaction with the solar wind and we're being buffeted by that energy and it's entering through that magnetospheric hole, the connection, then the K-index will rise because the geomagnetic field becomes very unstable or very active. You could think of it as people just trying to kink a hose, constantly moving those magnetic field lines around. Well, that activity has a result in lowering the energy level of the ionosphere because the magnetic field line, of course, punches through the ionosphere. And that's what happens. So the K-index is a measurement of geomagnetic activity. The higher the number, the more disturbed or active the geomagnetic field. The VioCap model takes that into consideration and says, okay, solar energy is at this level, geomagnetic activity is at this level, we're in the month of July, and we're analyzing this path. Statistically, over the course of decades, we've come to find that propagation will act in this way during those conditions. So the model is pretty accurate based on the long history of data that's been collected.
Okay, so it's not measuring actual radio signals bouncing around. It's measuring activity from the sun, looking at what that activity meant for propagation over years.
Right.
And saying, here's what it could likely be.
Right.
It sounds very much like the Weatherman on Channel 2.
Exactly. Just with less data points. So it could be wrong. There's what's called the reliability factor, and you set that in the software. The reliability factor, for instance, of 50% means that this probability, you will at least have half of a month in which these conditions will be true with these indexes, the K-index, the 10.7 centimeter, the sunspot. With those parameters, in a 50% reliability factor, at least half of the month, these conditions should be true. So if you set that to 90%, then you're asking the software to tell you what would happen 90% of the month. And I will tell you that most of the openings that were available 50% of the month will not be available 90% of the month.
You're going to be disappointed.
So it's much more conservative.
Yeah. And we're not talking about setting a prediction for noon tomorrow. We're talking about June.
Exactly. It's not, the model is a monthly smooth model. So it looks at what conditions would be throughout a month averaged, smoothed out. The ray tracing program, PropLab Pro, which is part of the course, you can get that as part of the course. It is a ray tracing model, which is based on the theoretical mathematical models of how the ionosphere is structured and how radio waves propagate. All of those equations are part of that model. And you can punch in the exact moment data, and it will ray trace, but it's very intense math, so you have to have a good computer with a fast processor, or it'll take hours. But it will ray trace and mathematically plot what you could expect between two points. And that's a little bit more of a day-to-day type of analysis. But for general propagation prediction, the programs that are based on VioCap, like ACHF, that will give you a highly accurate, prediction of what's going on, what you can expect.
My father-in-law, W4PVT, had been printing out these pages. I'm not sure where he got them, ARL or something, that show bands and parts of the planet and days or weeks. And I was thinking, that's useless. That's not going to really be telling you anything. Turns out I'm wrong. He's got something that's going to be useful. But if the band's not open today, it could very well be open tomorrow or the next day or the next day. At a 50% level, one of those 4 days, it's probably going to be open.
Right, right. You're looking at percentages.
Yeah, if the model says it's going to be open.
Right.
Interesting. Is there anything that you use that is more instantaneous about sort of a what is really happening right now?
There are some brand new technologies being deployed on the web by some major scientific communities that do nothing but solar forecasting. They're so new that there's not yet a lot of information on how to utilize it in a day-to-day scenario for the average ham. That's an area that I'm researching right now. But when Japan had its massive earthquake that, raised concerns about the nuclear radiation and the fallout and all of the things that happened with the tsunami, communications was a critical part of rescue operations and getting that infrastructure back in order. And they had difficulties with communications and forecasting and trying to leverage communications as best as possible for those operations, rescue operations, whatnot. So they called upon some scientific bodies to come up with some tool that would allow them to do exactly what you're saying. Give us a moment-by-moment blow based on current solar data and geomagnetic data. What's going on and what can we rely on and how can we get a signal from us into the region that we have such need to communicate with? So that model was created, and there are some amazing maps that are produced that shows the maximal usable frequencies in almost real time. But again, they're just being deployed, and it's typically been for governments and major heavy hitters, not so much for the amateur community. But I believe there are some ham radio scientists involved in this project, and they're trying to move it into the area of accessibility to the masses.
It occurs to me that I've heard of the software that will drive radios and check between two points, band by band.
ALE.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If something were able to tell them just where to go, that they wouldn't need to do that. They still need today to keep checking right. 10 megahertz, check 15 megahertz, check 5 megahertz, and see which one gives you a path. And nothing is going to tell you that right now.
That model that's been produced has a really high reliability factor. But again, there are always factors that we don't yet know about because we don't have the wealth of information from so many different points of observation, those data points. We don't have that many. So there are still anomalies. This brings up a point that I am very passionate about. In the beginning of ham radio, people experimented with electronics and discovered how to make a circuit transmit, discovered how to receive weak signals and regenerate them in such a way that we can intelligibly and usefully use that information. Experimenters and scientists, amateurs who were scientists and engineers. In a sense, we've lost some of that because Kenwood, Yaesu, ICOM, all of these really amazing companies with superb engineering have come up with these appliances that are phenomenal pieces of scientific engineering. We can hear the weakest signal. We have roofing filters that allow us to slice down that bandwidth and just hear that one signal in the middle of a symphony of signals. But we just operate that equipment. The maker generation and the QRP kit builders, they are, in a sense, bringing back the original essence of amateur radio, building, experimenting, trying new things. Propagation is an area that is wide open for experimentation and discovery. The amateur operator isn't just an appliance operator, but a true scientist. If you keep good logs, record the data, record what you know you were transmitting with this antenna and all these parameters, you log that information, and day after day you analyze that, eventually those numbers can be crunched, and you may be the one that discovered an anomaly in propagation that no one yet knew existed. That happens. Discoveries are still being made by amateur radio operators who operate despite what they hear. They think, you know, there's the solar minimum is extended for years. There's no solar activity. We're going into a maunder minimum. And sometimes I have tongue-tying issues. But they think it's dismal. And then they discover propagation exists that they didn't think ever would exist in these conditions. And how is that so? And that ferrets out new aspects of the ionosphere that we didn't understand before. Like, if the geomagnetic field is quiet for days on end, the ionosphere actually builds an energy level that normally wouldn't be built up and becomes a very solid player, giving us consistent, reliable communications, where during an active part of the solar cycle, it would be disrupted so many times with blackouts and disruptions on the solar wind that we never knew that opening even existed, and that path would have been open.
Yeah, so it won't be a high-frequency path, but it'll be a medium-frequency path that becomes very reliable, 20
right.
meters.
So
I guess that's why 20 is our go-to.
I encourage the amateur to get out there and experiment. Be that scientist.
If somebody does some experimenting and observes something like that, where do they go with that information? They could call I guess.
There's forums that are dedicated to this topic. I have some forums. Other people have forums. They're in Facebook, on Google+, there's groups that discuss these things. People write papers and submit them to like QST or CQ, and they get published for peer review. They postulate a theory. They say, this is what we observed. We think this is the mechanism of how this occurred. And they put out the theory. They put out the data. And then other people in the community will start reading that, and they'll print a rebuttal or letters to the editor and discuss it, and we see science moving forward. Our trade journals, QST, CQ Magazine, the Spectrum Monitor, they're not just for entertainment purposes. They are our professional publications, in a sense, our scientific publications, where we can bounce theories and ideas off of other amateurs in a peer review setting. That's what they're there for.
So we're just about out of time, but I do want to cover two related things. What the heck happened to this sunspot cycle, and what's going to happen to the next one, what, about 8 years from now?
Again, the data points aren't there, so this one was a surprise to the scientists.
But everybody's scared. Point. Everybody's scared to death that we are about to go flat for the rest of our lifetime.
We might. We don't know. There's no way to know. Here's the fact. If the sun is truly billions of years old, but our recorded time that we've observed the sun in any intelligent way is only maybe 400 years old, but truly intelligent discovery of the sun is only during the space age. And when did the space age occur? Well, it occurred in our lifetime. So we have this extremely small window of observation of this amazingly dynamic, mind-boggling thing we call a star. We are just babes in the middle of a nuclear science laboratory. We are just scratching the surface of understanding. So things are going to take us by surprise. The scientists, every time they're wrong, adjust their model, take the data into consideration, and try mathematically to rethink it. They do, in hindsight, begin to get things right, and it can give us an approximation of what might happen. I interviewed a scientist who has been observing a phenomenon in which sunspots appear to be dimming over time. As sunspots occur, they seem to be growing weaker, and that trend has continued. And so he's postulating, and most scientists laughed at him in the beginning, that we will see the disappearance of sunspots. They might be occurring, but we may not see them, and therefore the energy output is very low. They still occur, but not at the energy level that we are accustomed to based on the solar cycles we've observed. We don't know if there's a deeper cycle in the sun because we've only been observing for 400 years. What if there's a 2,000-year cycle? What if there's a 10,000-year cycle? We don't know these things. There's no way to know these things. But this scientist has postulated that, indeed, sunspot energy will decrease, and we will have a long period of possibly a sunspot cycle that has just a small amount of energy at its peak.
We know that the main sunspot cycle is about 11 years. It rides on
an average. Yeah, right.
It rides on another cycle that where we've got in those 400 years, I guess we've seen happen a few times. About
127. Yeah, there's the 27-year cycle, which is every 27 years there's a reversal of polarity. So one solar cycle of about 11 years has a polarity where the north and south pole are oriented in a certain way on the sun, and then it flips during the next solar cycle. So the 27-year cycle is underneath that 11-year cycle. Then we are postulating that there are longer-term cycles underneath that.
And we're not going to know for a couple hundred years.
Or thousands of years. Yeah.
Interesting. Well, we won't be around to know. So
that's right.
All we can do is enjoy what we've got and
make the best of it.
Yeah, yep. In the next cycle, see if it pumps up. I think I've got one, maybe two more cycles left of my own personal active hamming.
And we discovered that radio was red hot even during the silent period of the sun. This past minimum that was so extended, an amazing amount of DX occurred. We discovered that the bands could be utilized in ways we didn't expect, and there's plenty to do in amateur radio.
But it's those frequencies, 10 megahertz, 14 megahertz, not 21 and 28. But right. But the E layer is irrelevant to the sunspot cycle, right?
It has a different response to other outside forces. And the best explanation right now is that meteor dust that we ride through annually, every year we pass through certain comet trails. The meteor dust falls into the Earth's atmosphere, and at the region where the E layer exists, wind shears and some magnetic activity causes these particles to cluster into clouds, forming an ionization that gives us the sporadic nature of an E region with clouds of ionization that move about with the wind, the jet stream, etc.
Now, the E layer is relatively low, so distances that are reflected are less.
Right, because you have less of a bounce angle.
Yeah, so we're looking at 400 or 500 miles to a maximum of something under 2,000?
Correct. That's about right for the E region. Depending on the height does vary a little bit.
And they happen around now, this part of the year, May, June, into July a little bit.
And because there are some comet trails that are predominant during this time frame, right?
And then there's another, maybe I've heard a weaker one at the winter.
In the middle of the winter.
Yeah, winter. Mm-hmm. Now, it happens around the solstice, but evidently that doesn't have anything to do with it.
Yeah, it just appears to be meteor dust. That's the best model that's I think that's been postulated.
Every that's time a guess. We move, sounds like that's a guess.
It isn't exactly a guess. They've measured. There are probes that are being sent up, samples the Earth's atmosphere at different regions and discovered what particle and what chemistry is going on. And I think that's been the best model that's come out so far from the research that's been done.
Okay, so it's a strong correlation.
Very strong correlation.
But they can't say for sure that that's what's happening.
Probably not. But okay. I think it's close to a sure.
And there's so much about this that is observation and correlation and not absolute provable science.
Yes, but there is a lot of funding going on. Again, the E region is going to cause some of your satellite communications to be disrupted. And there's a lot of money in satellite communications. It's the backbone of our global communication system. And so satellite companies and governments pour a lot of money into research. So you are seeing different types of direct measurement of what's going on in the chemistry of those regions.
Yeah. So they're concerned about it, which is another interesting point. In the early days of radio and through its adolescence, propagation, the spectrum that we could use was the HF spectrum to get signals around the world. We could use VHF and UHF, but they didn't go very far, so it was all local stuff. And people got sick and tired of that. It's not reliable enough. We are going to put satellites up there. We're going to make our own propagation worldwide.
Right, exactly. And so a big repeater in the sky.
Yeah, everybody with the money to do it went up there. And now they care about all this stuff because they don't want the satellites to be blown up. But
when the geomagnetic field is highly disturbed, satellites experience drag, and it causes them to lower themselves in orbit and move out of orbit.
Oh, so it's physically grabs them.
It physically grabs satellites and slows them down and changes orbits. And there's a lot of science that goes on with satellite.
Yeah, and they can reestablish their orbit if they've got some a rocket on them. Right. But they can't. They can't stop at a gas station and get more gas.
Right. Once there's a lifespan.
Yeah, they've used up their fuel, then they're plunging back to Earth. Well, this has been great. You've already given us a bunch of things that I never knew about, and I think even folks who are fairly knowledgeable about propagation are familiar with. But is there anything that is an absolute surprise that you think very few people will understand about it?
Because I think the media says this and people repeat what they hear in sound bites. Again, a solar flare does not head toward the Earth and arrive days later. That's not accurate. A solar flare is instantaneous, 8 minutes, and it's here. And when that energy dissipates, the blackout's gone. Everything recovers. So it's an instantaneous, sudden ionospheric disturbance. So a solar flare does arrive. It does go toward the Earth, but it's here in 8 minutes. So by the time we know that there's a flare, it's already here. But a coronal mass ejection is what the newscaster is truly talking about.
They just got their language wrong.
They just got their language wrong. So, you know, I am kind of a stickler for giving the right name to the right thing. And if there's anything that surprises people when they start to correlate this, is that they can actually begin to understand that when that solar flare occurred, a couple of days later, they may see that 40 meters propagates differently than they were used to, and their daily net's going to change, and they got to get a different control operator in a different region or whatever, and they begin to unlock the secrets. So understanding the basics will start to unlock your power of use on HF. But back to the question, what surprises me? What surprises me sometimes are the things we're seeing on the sun now with our extremely high-definition satellite, the SDO. We are seeing things that the naked eye in telescopes and other satellites never saw before and never knew existed on the sun. We've seen, in a sense, tidal waves that start in one spot on the sun and literally move out like a tidal wave and cover the entire surface of the visible part of the sun. And we see these powerful changes in the magnetic orientation of different regions on the sun and that producing energy. We never knew those kinds of things occurred. We had no idea of the scale of activity that the sun is giving us. So there's, in a sense, a constant surprise every day as we watch in real time what's going on with our sun. It's an amazing thing.
Do we know what effect do they have on radio or anything else? Or we just seen them and now we're looking to correlate them?
We're trying to correlate, and there's a lot of research papers. Again, there's a whole strata of academia dedicated to unraveling the secrets of the sun, and papers are published all the time that put together models based on the data that's being streamed off of SDO, and we're just beginning that process. It's an amazing field.
And we have,
if you're a young person, get into space weather, get into math, and get into the physics side of science. And solar scientists are highly in demand of an amazing field that you can get into.
There you go. And for hams, there's still plenty of opportunity for discovery.
That's right.
Cool. You are in a lot of different places in the CQ, in Spectrum Monitor, several places on the web. Where's the one best place to go find you first, and then we'll take people every place else?
There's a Facebook page.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it's on
Facebook.
It's the last thing you probably expected, but I will tell you, I have just about 10,000 people that are congregated to that page that interact with me. It's an amazing phenomenon. Social media
Facebook
is becoming the normal. It's a very useful thing. So on Facebook, if you look for space weather as a keyword, but basically it's facebook.com/spacewx.hfradio. That'll get you directly to the page.
All right. Tomas Hood, NW7US. Thank you very much. Appreciate your coming on and giving us all this great information. And let's try this again in a little while, and maybe we can hone in on a few specific things.
Pick one little aspect and yeah, we can explore it.
Yeah, because this was pretty much the shotgun.
Yep.
All right, let me tell everybody in the background that Arvin has been watching the whole thing. I don't know if he's learned anything. Arvin, there is going to be a quiz, so I hope you were paying attention. If you enjoy the program, feel you've got something out of it, after you go by Tom's and sign up for his course, come by hamradionow.tv and click Arvin's icon and help us out too. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ 73. See you, Thomas. Wait a minute. I'll let you say goodbye to everybody.
Hey, 73 to everybody. See you on the air. Digital modes. I'll be there.
All right. Over and out.